สวัสดีเจ้าพิมพ์เขมสิงคี editor of City Life and I'm back here on my daybed today with my dear friend Shuman Taran. Did I pronounce it properly?
Yes, that's about right. Shuman Taran.
That's exactly what I said.
Exactly.
Surely. So Shuman and I have, I mean, I've known you, I've seen you around for years and years. How long have you been in Chiang Mai?
Been here for 5 years.
Right, well,
and I've heard a lot about you long before I actually met you.
All lies. Were they good?
They were very good.
All true.
You are sort of a legend in Chiang Mai, and I always wanted to be your friend on Facebook, but I also didn't want to be a stalker. So I finally bumped into you, I think, at a birthday party 2 years ago. And I weaseled my way and sat with you next to you on the sofa and said, "Hi, Pim, my name's Shuman. I've heard so much about you.
Really?
I want to be your friend." Oh. It was at Thomas's birthday.
Oh, yes, that's right.
And then you told me, "Yes, I know who you are."
Of course I do. and then oddly, like, you know how the pandemic, you just become really, you've become friends with like really random people that you weren't before? We became friends because we had a Catan group. We played really geeky board games every Tuesday.
Tuesday night, we would congregate and start off with a little potluck dinner of some sort,
yep.
And then play Catan, which for some reason I actually introduced to our game group.
Yeah.
Long before we did the game night.
And lost every game.
And I was doing so well, and I taught all these people, and then I start, hello. And I started losing every single game.
So there we go. Just, you know, random friends, now good friends. So Shuman, in case you can't tell, is an actor. Yes, you've been around the block around Chiang Mai a bit, haven't you?
I have.
So let's start with you. Let's. Who are you? What's your background?
So I am from Malaysia, and not many people really know much about Malaysia. It's very strange how Malaysia and Thailand are right next to each other. Everyone knows everything about Thailand.
Yeah.
Nobody knows anything about Malaysia.
Yeah, I don't know too much.
Classic example, you go to Malaysia, it's packed out with Thai restaurants. Now, how many Malaysian restaurants do you have in Thailand?
One in Chiang Mai, I believe.
I don't think it's even Malaysian.
Oh, really?
It's Indonesian.
Oh.
See? So it's funny how this country is so well known around the world. In fact, when I was in the UK, this was in late 80s, and people say, "Where are you from?" And I'm Malaysian. Is that north of Tanzania?
Oh,
and
Jesus.
I'm like, "No, that's in Africa." Well, isn't Malaysia in Africa? No. That's how.
Yeah. Well, we get the Taiwan, Thailand.
Yeah, a little
often.
Bit there. I also hear we'll talk about that in a minute, about my real job. But when people call me up and I say, "Well, we're in Chiang Mai, Shanghai."
Oh, yeah.
No, not Shanghai, Chiang Mai. And so, yes, there's always name confusion.
Yes, always that. But so, Malaysia.
Malaysian, of Sri Lankan descent. So I'm brown, like Indian, but not. And I grew up in a military family. So we moved around in Malaysia a lot.
You don't look it.
No. My dad was military. No, I'm very not military.
Yes.
And I grew up in a time when the national language of Malaysia was English. My parents spoke English, and so did my grandparents. And it was the first language I learned. So my education in Malaysia was crap. Because
so
I
don't speak.
I didn't learn the language of Malaysia till I was in my early teens. And I did it very badly.
That's quite appalling.
It is. You
grew up there.
It is. It was adamant. I refused to learn the language that wasn't mine. And yet I didn't have a language.
Yeah,
because
exactly.
My parents never spoke Tamil, which is the language of Sri Lankan Tamils. But cut a long story short, I ended up studying in the UK, studying law, but was more interested in theatre. And I got a job in one of the bigger shows, Les Miserables, in London.
Doing what?
It was just silly front of house stuff, first tearing tickets and then keeping people's coats in a cloakroom.
Those are not quite treading the ball.
No, not on stage. No, not carrying a flag and singing "Do You Hear the People Sing?" But the reason for working in the theatre was to satisfy my need to see other shows. But I didn't think it through.
Oh.
working in a theater gives you access to theater, but you're working at the same time when all the other shows are going on.
You did not think that one.
No, I didn't.
Through.
I was not very clever. No. But I was very clever at lying to my management. They were wondering why I was sick all the time. I'm like, I can't come to work. And they spot me at the Phantom of the Opera or at some other show. But my interest was watching theater.
Oh.
Came back from England after 7 years of earning lots of money and,
What?
Just working in the theater.
Okay.
Oh, I knew how to earn money.
All right. What good on you?
More importantly, I got to meet some amazing people.
Really?
Many of them I've told you before.
Yeah.
Do you want
to
hear some of them?
Go for it. Yeah. You worked with some of the best.
I worked under Andrew Lloyd Webber because that's his theater, but I hobnobbed with rather interesting people. Like I used to go out on Tuesday nights, like we do in Chiang Mai, with Anthony Hopkins.
And now he goes out with me.
With him.
Bit of a
on the same level.
Step down.
I don't think so. I used to walk Eartha Kitt home, not home really, part of the way, after his shows in
what,
London.
She trust you to take her to her front door.
I think she sort of, yes. She did most of Tottenham Court Road with me, and then she sort of said, I think it's time for you to go now. Sweet little lady, and you know, it was great.
Yeah.
And when I came back to Malaysia, I hated it, Malaysia. And I needed to be a foreigner again. And like Dick Whittington, packed my stuff in a bag on my back and got on a bus from the southern part of Malaysia. 27 hours later, arrived in Bangkok.
Oh.
Not knowing the language, not having a friend, not knowing anything except for Joe Cummings' Lonely Planet.
Joe Cummings, you're next on my sofa.
Joe Cummings, I've told you this several times. Without you, I wouldn't be here. So
I did my first writing gig with him as well.
Oh, you did?
Paid writing
lovely
job
guy.
Lonely Planet.
Here in Chiang Mai a lot.
Yeah, I used to live here. Yeah.
What, in this house?
Well, not in, not on the daybed. Just across town.
Yes, we have rubbed shoulders, and I've told him many times, you know, he is. And I was talking about the Lonely Planet the other day. A lot of people who traveled with it still use it. I use it.
Really? Still?
If I have to go somewhere bizarre, like, you know, oh, I don't know, South Africa, I would buy a Lonely Planet.
That bizarre place,
no,
South Africa.
It's not that bizarre, but I couldn't think of anything more. So.
So, okay, Bangkok.
Started like most people who came to Thailand as an English teacher. Hated it.
I can see that.
Within a year, I was actually running a school.
Okay, I did not see that.
Yes. So, yes, I was in education, but I like bossing people around.
I can see that.
Yes. So, ran a school, quite a horrendous branch of the AUA Language Center.
Oh.
That was doing very badly. And I had this wonderful concept. Hire good-looking teachers, and the students will come. And that's what I did.
Okay. I'm not entirely sure that the education's...
It worked. Well,
okay.
I trained them to teach,
oh,
but
okay.
The students started coming in because... tell me seriously, when you were in school, did you not learn better from a good-looking teacher?
No. Absolutely. Wow. I did not fancy my teachers. That's kind of gross.
I use that to help my students learn English.
Okay. Whatever
now,
works.
One day, went out with a couple of teacher friends from a different branch, and someone said, I am missing an actor in a play. Do you want to step in? And I'm like, it sounds difficult, but fun as well. Yeah. So I said, yeah, why not?
So you hadn't actually acted until that point.
No, I've done a few little things in school, but nothing of noteworthy. And I said, yeah, we'll do it. And the funny thing was, it's a play that the words aren't really English, but they are English.
Right on the street, confusion.
Like, instead of the word ass, you'd say asp, you know? Wait. I want you to hit my asp. And so trying to learn that play was a nightmare because it was gobbledygook.
Okay, yeah.
But I pulled through, did reasonably well. And then I joined...
What was this again?
This was in the year 2000.
Oh, wow. Okay, a while back.
For the Bangkok Community Theatre, one of the more established theatre companies run by expatriates in Bangkok. And a year later, they asked me if I would like to direct something. And I am wacky. I like to direct
Yeah.
things that are risque. So I found a play called The Hardy Boys and the Mystery of Where Babies Come From.
I didn't realize it was still a mystery.
Well, it is apparently to these two boys. And it featured the two Hardy Boys, and they are in their bedroom about to go to bed, and they suddenly have this discussion about where babies come from. And I said, I want these boys, and they're rather good looking, to be in the skimpiest underwear.
I hope by boys they weren't
They weren't
boys.
young boys. They
Okay, they
were
weren't
adult
boys. Okay,
men,
all
but
right.
nothing more appealing than two men in tighty whities.
Yes, yes.
But they were rather awkward. They said, no, we can't do that. They went with boxer shorts. But that's the kind of stuff I do.
Yes, that's the kind of
I
stuff you
like to
do. Yeah.
appeal to the attraction value of teachers and actors.
Obviously, good-looking people is what works for you.
That's why I
That's
hang out
why
with you.
you were attracted to me.
Exactly.
Yes, obviously.
So time goes by. I do some stuff with the Bangkok Community Theatre, and then I broke away from them. Then I was invited back on their committee. Did quite a lot of plays in Bangkok. Enjoyed it. And then 5 years ago, I was given a job offer here in Chiang Mai with a drug and alcohol rehab.
That's right, but wait, let's go back to your film because you were in some films, right?
I was the a very. First film I did was out of sheer accident. I belong to an expat group on the net. I think
Yeah.
it's expat.com or something silly like that. And I rarely checked it. And I don't know how there was a notification on my inbox again, which I rarely look at. And I decided to click it on as I was about to get on a plane and said, "We're looking for a Malaysian person in a film. Are you interested?" And there was a name and number. And the name of the production company was De Warren Films, which I'd heard of because a good friend of mine, Don Linder,
I know Don Linder,
he was
interviewed him.
actually my boss at AUA
Oh,
when I was hiring all those good-looking actors,
I can't
teachers.
imagine him approving, to be honest.
I think he liked the idea as well. He knew I was bringing in money. That's all that mattered.
Okay.
Yeah, Don Linder had just recently finished filming The Last
Let
Executioner.
me just interject. If you haven't heard about it, it's fascinating. We did a cover story on this many, many years ago.
Yeah.
He basically spent a lot of time with the last executioner
Chowalit.
of Thailand, Chowalit, who was a big Elvis guitar player and part-time and an executioner as a job, which is quite extraordinary. Yeah, so
Yes, and
watch
an
the documentary.
amazing film as well. There's a sequence in that film that's rather upsetting about that woman who was executed but didn't die, and they had to
Oh.
re-execute her.
Okay, at this point I can bullshit and just go, oh yes, or I can admit that I actually haven't watched the film.
Well, do watch it. It's worth
Which I
watching.
haven't. Sorry, Don.
I knew the company that had written to me
Yeah.
wasn't fake. So I rang them up just as I was boarding the plane to Krabi on a holiday and said, "Interested? We'll call you when I land." And I end up going for a screen test at De Warren Films. And when I walked in, they're like, you could see the look of puzzlement on their face. And they said, "Are you Malaysian?" I am. And then it dawned on me. They were looking for a Malay actor.
Oh.
Now, a lot of people don't realize Malaysia, like Thailand or America, has a
Of
whole
course.
mixture of people. They're Thai Indians, like they're Thai Malaysians. And I said, "I am Malaysian." They said, "Okay, what we really need is someone who speaks Malay." Well, I can do that. Okay.
Not well.
By that time, from
Okay.
16 to 40, I'd learned enough Malay to say, yes, can do that. And I was actually hired as the language consultant on the film, which meant I had to make sure all the signage and the menus and all that stuff was
Oh,
written
wow.
correctly. And they said, "We'd like you to be in the film as the prison warden." I'm like, I would be in the film for prison sweeper. I don't care. I want to be in a film. And they said, "All right, you're going to do a screen test. You're going
Yeah.
to sit at this table and pretend it's a console with lots of TV screens. And you're going to see a prisoner escape, and you get alarmed, and you're going to scream out in Malay all these words about ring the alarm, the prisoner's escaping." And there I am with nothing but a table, and everything's in your mind. And I can act, But if I have the right props and scenario, but to put me on an empty table and imagine everything, I get
Yeah,
panic attacks.
challenge.
And I could not remember on, like, I didn't know the word for alarm in Malay.
Oh, shit.
And so heart's pounding, and I'm, well, heart's pounding, sorry, microphone. And I realize, hang on, these people need me as a language consultant. They don't know a word of Malay. I could throw in the word for cat and they wouldn't know. That's what I
So,
did.
what film has now got really shitty Malay words?
Thank God they didn't use my language skills a lot vocally, but it's a mechanic resurrection.
Is that with Jason
That's with Jason Statham.
Statham? Yeah.
It was a very exciting film for me. It's the first time I'm doing a Hollywood film,
Yeah.
let alone a film. And I had screen time with Jason Statham, very friendly bloke. It was shot in an unused prison in Chanterbury.
Ooh.
And where better to find prison extras than to recruit all the released prisons from that prisoners from that prison?
So it's quite naughty.
So 400 or so of my extra friends were prisoners.
My, my.
They looked like
That's
prisoners.
thrilling.
They're all, undernourished, they're all tattooed, they're all rough, and they were being brought back to the prison they were
God,
serving
that's going to
life.
suck. That's weird.
They loved
They
it.
loved it.
They took me around saying, "This is where my brother and I were in prison, and he was murdered by that guy because of the food they were
Oh
serving.
my
And over
God.
there, that cell's where this guy was there." And
Were they all out of prison now?
they were all given a royal pardon because there was flooding and many people, prisoners died. And the government said, "Get rid of all the prisoners, let them go, close the prison down."
So, okay, so then 5 years ago, you got a job offer at a rehab center of all places. How did that
Yep.
come about? And what was
Well,
your role?
I'm going to backtrack a bit. So I did the
Backtrack.
mechanic resurrection, did 6 days of filming. It was great. Did another film called All I See Is You with Blake Lively. Now, she wasn't very lively. I also did a Swedish film called The 101-Year-Old Man Who Skips on His Bill and Disappears,
Okay.
which is a sequel to The 100-Year-Old Man Who Blah, 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 Blah.
Okay, he's a busy 100-year-old man.
Yes, and that's on Netflix, and it still is.
Really? Okay.
I tend to play people in uniform. Now, coming
So
to
not
Chiang
you.
Mai, a friend of mine said, "There's a great job in a rehab. Would you be interested? It's a sales job." And I said, "No. One, sales. I hate sales. Number two, Chiang Mai. What am I going to do there? It's like going to some out-of-town place like Des
Be a
Moines or
snob, Des Moines.
Bognor Regis or something silly like that." And within 24 hours of arriving in Chiang Mai, was in love with it.
Really?
Yes.
Where, I mean, who did you know anyone?
I had a friend here who took me out to a little place called Drinksmith.
Ah,
And the minute I walked in Drinksmith, I said, "I'm going to live here." And I loved it. And
okay.
I've loved it ever since.
Because, that was probably the most Bangkok-esque bar in
It
town at the
was. They
time.
moved now. I've not been to the
Oh,
new
really? I
one.
haven't been to the new one.
But I realize when you come here on holiday, your perspective of a town or a city is so different. You don't make mental notes of where to buy cat food or where to, get your car washed. When you're on holiday, it's just temples and your hotel and restaurants.
Restaurants, yeah.
Now you need to find secret places to park on Niman and where do you get your laundry done, that sort of stuff.
Yeah, and it's fun exploring all that here, isn't
And
it?
Chiang Mai is so easy to get around if you have your transport. There's so much fabulous restaurants and great food at a fraction of the cost of Bangkok.
Well, unfortunately, most people earn a fraction of what they earn in Bangkok. But you had a
Most,
good rehab
most.
job, didn't you?
I did
You still
well
do.
initially, better than now, but I'm surviving
Yeah.
and I wouldn't give it up.
What do
And
you do again with the
so
rehabby?
I'm an admissions manager, which means when someone has an issue or their loved one has an issue, they call us up. I'm the one that answers the phone. I have to be very sympathetic and empathetic and be
Is that
nice.
hard? Is that a bit of
So
acting?
there is a lot of acting that goes on. Some of them are just, dullily and loopy, but you need to understand where they're coming from,
Course.
give them the best advice and help you can. And I would say I'm one of the luckiest people in that organization called the cabin. which is well known around the world.
Very well known.
They gradually kept shrinking during COVID.
Of course.
To the point where we were down to 33 employees.
And a height of
from about 280 employees.
Oh my God, seriously?
And I was the last, we'll call myself Farang for this purpose, the last Farang standing, except for two people in HR and an accountant. The rest were all disappeared.
Yeah. Wow.
So I have been gainfully employed for the 5 years I've been in Chiang Mai.
Yeah, you really have. And apart from that, this one is all over the shop with every stage that sort of happens to pop up in Chiang Mai, there'll be a Schumann. You know, just this year alone. And you know I'm not a performance arts person. I've never really appreciated concerts or plays or theatre just because I grew up in Chiang Mai and I just didn't have it, right? So I have been going to some, but he has sulked because I've missed a few others as well. So tell us a little bit about the theatre scene here and how you got into it.
It's
growing, right?
It is. It is. It's active and in many ways even more active than Bangkok. But the sad thing is, when we talk about theatre in the Western sense of the word, there's not a lot. But if you look at Thai theatre, there's something happening all the time that we don't know. There are performances happening every weekend.
Really? Like where?
In little restaurants, in little cafes, in...
Thai theatre?
Yeah. A player recently did that you came to 10 by 10 by 10. I was adamant to be a lot more inclusive and get some Thais involved. And I got this really nice, pleasant Thai guy who was doing drama lecturing at CMU. And he came on board. Unfortunately, they relinquished his job, cut the program, and sent him to Bangkok. And I looked at his posts. And one of the things that we're looking at doing at the Gate Theatre, which we'll come back to, is a play called Kiss of the Spider Woman. It's a two-hander, two men in a South American prison.
Okay.
Very heavy play. And a week before 10 by 10, that same play, rebranded as The Kiss, done by Thais in a restaurant.
Which restaurant?
I have no idea. But later on, when I spoke to him,
I was curious because I don't see these plays everywhere.
He said, you know, there's a lot of social media postings. They're not big, they're not extravagant, but it's performance art.
So there's a lot of local theatre groups now. I mean, I know Lan Yim.
Yeah, Lan Yim does stuff.
Theatre group.
There's a woman named Sunoko. Have you heard of her? She does stuff.
She sounds nice.
She does. I think she is. And the sad thing is, you have to go look for it.
Yeah.
Unlike in if this was London or New York, it looks for you.
It does.
So here you need to know where to look to find these things. A lot of it's by word of mouth.
So like theatre, like there used to be one theatre group, which was the Gate Theatre.
The Gate Theatre
has been founded.
Started about 16 years ago by now.
Van Turner.
And
had five lines in one play once.
Yes, and what was that? Steel Magnolias?
It was another really depressing, heavy one. Oh. It was the Laramie Project.
Oh, yes. Is that where they chained the boy to murder him? Yes.
It was pretty bleak.
The Gate, Stephen Turner at The Gate, has done a lot for theatre in Chiang Mai, but he's very passionate and serious about his theatre, and it does show in the shows that he does, which are very passionate and serious. Now, as you can tell, I'm...
passionate, but not serious.
I'm on the opposite spectrum. I'm a silly billy. And I like silly things.
You do. You are
and,
a silly billy.
And so, although I'm the artistic director as of now for the Gate Theatre, my aim is to bring in light, cheerful, silly things.
How did he hand it over to you?
I think we'd...
How did you angle it out of
I
his...
don't think I got handed over. It's just a title. I have not risen to his expectations, so I could be fired any day now. This is in 3 months. We'll really know in 3 months. What it is I have a very good eye for things that are not in place. I'll give you an example. I went to see a play once in Bangkok, and the guy looked really good. Except he had one little gray hair that he missed dying on his beard. And all through that night, my eyes and focus was on his beard. And it was driving me crazy. So that's what Stefan saw in me, that
Right.
I could tell that that wallpaper is slightly askew.
So he notices your attention to detail.
Yes.
Yeah.
And
I'd like to hear about the theater scape of Chiang Mai. What do we have
so
going on
we
now?
have the Gate Theater, who's done between one to two and then three and as many as eight plays, I think, or seven at one time. Who knows?
Wow, that's a
And
lot.
a lot of it's been controlled by Stefan Turner. And we have proposed stuff. I proposed 10 by 10, which was a drive to bring in new actors. What's currently coming on is the play version of the movie Nuts by Barbra Streisand. It's a courtroom drama, which they have to do every year because they do a lot of work with Lana Lawyers and Babsicle.
Okay.
So they sponsor a legal play every
Oh,
year.
really? Interesting.
And then at the same time, in fact, after this interview, I'm running off to an audition for a play called The Christmas Choir, just to help him audition, but I'm not directing that.
Right.
I'm taking a hiatus. I'm tired.
Really? I didn't
I am.
expect that.
I've
I mean,
had.
we're going to talk next about what he's just come out of and been doing,
Yes.
but let's focus
The
still on the
theater.
escape. Yeah, the theater escape.
There is theater. It's good theater. It's heavy, sometimes a little depressing.
How many theatre groups are there?
There right now, there are three. The Gate Theatre, the
The Flaming
oldest.
Horse, Black
The
Horse,
Dark
Dark
Horse.
Horse.
And it, no, it's nothing to do with horses and racism, but
Didn't think
Dark
it
Horse is run by a lovely lady called Kelly Holiday. I've never met her, but I've spoken to her many times, and she does very interesting stuff in very unconventional places as well.
Oh, interesting. Like what?
She did one in that open air arena thing that's sunken in near Lan Yim.
Yes,
Yeah.
yes, yes, yes.
And it was brilliant. I'm like,
Okay.
it's what I would like to
I'd
do.
like to talk to her because I like doing events at weird places.
Yes. And I'm very open to the idea of doing a play in a rice field or under a unused flyover, a
Bit
basketball
loud.
court. There are ways around it.
Okay.
And then there is the Actor Factory, which has only put on a couple of productions of the Pirates of Chemotherapy, but they do a lot of events.
Therapy. Seriously, can we not have something a
It
bit more
sounds,
uplifting?
actually, the Pirates of Chemotherapy has some sad moments in it, but it's rather funny in many parts. It's a light view of breast cancer, but yeah, I think someone does die, but it's funny pretty much most of the time.
Okay.
So that's the theater in Chiang
Wow.
Mai.
And
We
then there's a lot of things like I know it's loosely connected, but things like spoken word, stand-up comedy, there's the creative scene is
is
really,
going up every
right?
day.
And how is it all coming together? Do you all communicate? Do you all work together?
Uh,
Is it all fresh blood? What is it?
I strongly believe, and a lot of us do, that we need to work together.
Yeah.
And there are some organizations that find that very hard because they're very protective. I am a,
Is there drama?
yes, it's that prima donna
identity or crisis there.
He's not exempt.
I am so into getting people together, and as you can tell, the Comedy Club Bangkok brings their comedy shows up here, and they didn't even ask. I jumped in there and said, "What can I do for you? You want me to tear tickets? Do you want me to direct people to their seats? Oh, I want to help you, Chris," and that's what I do. And then there's a local comedy, a stand-up comedy thing that happens at the Score, the old
Score.
Cheryl's.
All right.
There is there's a lot of open mics in little places like
Yes.
Corner Bistro and
Rambar.
Rambar. Is not actually the story about me and Rambar is this.
Yes, he hangs out at Rambar a lot.
I am. They should change it to the Schumann Bar
I don't
or
think they will.
Shambar.
Shambar. Yes.
It's all a sham.
It is.
The manager is one of the nicest people I've ever
Oh,
met. He's
amazing.
a simple guy from Buriram, and that's how the name Rambar came about.
Oh, Ram.
Yeah.
Oh, Michelle Ram.
No, it's nothing to do with male sheep. And he's the sweetest guy, and me and our close friend Sompon would go out there and hang out just to chill out.
Just to get a chance to get on stage, I reckon.
Not initially, but the more we saw their performance, now you must understand, I've got some relatives visiting and they wanted to see a ladyboy show. And my go-to place, the Ranbar. There's another one called Sixgrit.
Yeah.
And there are two big ones that nobody really knows about called Siam Dragon and another in big theaters.
Minujak, I don't know it. Can I?
So I took them to Ranbar, and there's something about these performance by ladyboys.
Yeah.
Number one, they put any woman to shame. They're gorgeous. But they don't look like that. Mm. You see them out of makeup, they're regular guys. The amount of training and effort they have to do in getting their makeup right, the dance moves, the clothes.
And so confident, you know?
Confident.
They just go out there, yeah.
Running around in heels. Yeah. Okay, climbing up tiny spiral stairs and sliding down bars.
I can't do that.
And they do it for a miserable amount of money.
Yeah.
And it's not about the money. It's about performance. Yeah. And I look at them and I always, you know, I don't want to be a ladyboy, but I love their energy. And to help the Ranbar, what I've decided is to try and throw as many events I can in there. Pretty much, he says, you can use the bar anytime before 9:30 any night.
Schumann just celebrated his 55th birthday there, which I missed and I got into big trouble for.
It's all over the net, though.
It's all over the net. And all his friends came, many of them, and everyone performed. Everyone put on a skit.
It was a night of singing, dancing,
stand-up
comedy, mentalist acts. We had to cut it down. There were people. There was going to be Mexican dancers, flamenco dancers. And it was becoming a bit too much. We talked of doing it over several weeks.
Oh my God.
But we've decided to abandon that idea. It was one spectacular night.
Yes, I think that's...
And it showed me there are lots of people who want to do stuff, but they're scared.
Yeah.
They're scared of professional performances where people are paying money and they expect so much from the performance. Whereas what I do now allows those who are a bit worried to try something. It doesn't matter if they fail or it goes wrong. It's all a good laugh.
I agree. You see, I would. He's been trying to get me to sing a duet with him. And I would do it in that setting, maybe. But I would not do it in a paid setting because I would feel like I'm just cheating people out
exactly.
of their
head. Exactly. Even me. I mean, I sound like a frog when I sing. But I do it because it gives me the practice. It shows me where my loopholes are, and maybe one day I'll be good enough to do it professionally, but it's done therapeutically to see, you know, if I can do this okay.
Okay, then now let's talk about your latest project, which you just finished, which is very, very exciting, and which we can all watch. When is it going to be aired?
Tomorrow.
No, really?
Tomorrow. It's a bit mind-boggling because tomorrow is not actually tomorrow in this side, on this side of the planet.
And also, by the time you watch this,
it'll be out
weeks ago.
You'd have watched it by now.
Yeah.
So it's being premiered prime time in the US on October 14th, which is for us tomorrow, but it's 2 days away in America. So it's Saturday for us.
Yeah.
And it's called Shantaram, based
Netflix.
Not Netflix, Apple TV. We
not
need
Netflix.
To.
Sorry, not Netflix.
Sorry, maybe not Netflix.
Apple TV.
One of those Netflix-like things. Yeah. Apple TV. Now, here's where the big headache is. Everyone has Netflix, and everyone has Amazon Prime, or something, you know, or Disney, or HBO. Apple TV. Now, how many people have that? Maybe about 0.8% of the world's population.
Oh,
it's not a very well subscribed thing. No. But this is where Shantaram is clever. Not Shantaram, Apple TV. This story has been around for over 20 years. It was written by a man who actually, it did happen to him. He lived in Melbourne. He was a heroin addict. He, to fuel his addiction, he robbed a bank, got imprisoned. He actually crawled over the front walls of that prison in Australia and escaped. But he wanted to get out of Australia to a country where he couldn't be extradited. And so he was planning to go to Germany. And in the 80s, you can't fly perhaps direct from Sydney to Germany. So his flight stopped in Mumbai or Bombay. He got out, fell in love with it. And to cut a long story short, he ends up in the slums and he's revered. And he spends a lot of time helping the slum people. And he gets their term of endearment or reverence, which is Shantaram.
Wow.
And he also gets involved with the local mafia and the gangsters. So it's when you do watch this series, and it'll be halfway through the season when you get to see this interview, it appeals to everyone. It appeals to women for the emotional slum side. It'll appeal to men because there's gangsters and guns and killings and escape. It's one of those that has everything for everyone.
And the he that he's talking about is Charlie
Hunnam. Charlie Hunnam.
Really hot guy.
He's the lead that
so that's a bit that appeals to some women.
Yes. So he's a good looking actor. I would brand him as the Brad Pitt, the young Brad Pitt of England. Okay.
I thought he was Australian.
He plays an Australian, but he's English. He's English. And he's famous basically for Sons of Anarchy.
Yeah.
And he's done quite a few other films, including the new remake of Papillon. And lots. I can't.
But you had fun? And so what's your character?
So I was asked to be one of the 12 core slum dwellers. Now, there are about 1,000 people on set. And it's in a slum that looks like it's in Mumbai, but it actually is filmed in Thailand. Klong Toei is a real slum.
Oh.
That's where we were housed.
Oh.
We were housed in a hotel near Klong Toei. Okay. But no, they got a large piece of land near Suvarnabhumi Airport, near the Gulf of Thailand. So it's a swampy place, lots of snakes, lots of mosquitoes. There was one particular person on set called Snake Coordinator or something like that. Jesus. Snake Director.
Oh, fun fact. I just learned that every single year, Bangkok Municipality catches 60,000 snakes.
That's a lot.
One snake every 15 minutes. I mean, that's just nasty.
Have you had a snake in this house?
The 2-meter cobra skin was hanging off their skin. And I never knew where the cobra went.
I live in a forest area. I live up on the hill. I've not seen a single snake.
Good.
Scorpion or centipede?
Good, lucky you. Anyway, back to...
I think my dogs eat them.
She doesn't eat anything. Okay. Well, no, she eats everything, but she doesn't kill anything.
Right.
She's useless.
So, they had a lot of people on set in a slum that looked like it was from Mumbai. And they needed some core slum dwellers. And that's where I come in. I was rather disappointed that I didn't actually get a character name.
What? Yeah.
I'm known as Sonam's husband. Now, I haven't read the book. It's quite widely read among younger travelers and Australians. And I'm like, this Sonam woman must be some phenomenal woman for her to have a character name and I'm just her husband. And nothing really happens in season one, but Sonam, the...
your wife?
Character, my wife, and I, her husband, are hopeful that we make it into season two and something does happen.
There we go. Fingers crossed. So was it fun? Tell us some highlights.
What I'm going to say is going to dispel a lot of wannabe movie stars. Being on a movie is one of the most boring careers you can ever have. Unless you're an A-lister and you get your own trailer and your nails are painted for you and your food's brought to you.
It's waiting, isn't it?
It is boring for the fact that a lot of your time, I would say close to 90% of your time, is waiting.
Yeah.
You get into costume, you get your makeup done, whatever they need to do with you, and then you wait and wait and wait and wait. And filming is usually a 12-hour block.
Yeah.
And it could either be 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. for a daylight shoot or 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. for a night shoot. And there are times you're sitting around from, say, 6 a.m. And at 5:55, they say, "All right, go back to the green room, get changed, you're going home. We're not filming you today." It's happened to me several
times. Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah, that would be, I couldn't stand that.
And the beauty of it is, for those making money, it's well paid. But those who want to be on the screen and see their faces being filmed on camera, like me,
yes,
not very exciting.
Yeah, because you were well paid, but
But
you didn't even get a
name. One of the things I realize I've done in the six films I've been in, and my casting people are quite amazed at it, is I never ask how much they're going to pay me. Mm. Never. Not from the first film, and not even at Shantaram.
It's a snob.
And I do it because I don't want to jinx it, for the reason of every film I've done, I've been highly paid, way more than I expected. Extremely happy. But I don't do it for the money. I do it for...
Money ain't bad.
The fun, the watching how they put everyone together, the production people, the cameras, the lightings, the sound.
Yeah.
When you're filming...
So you enjoy it. You really get a buzz
it is. To see something... It's going from 0 to 100.
Mm.
Something that looks drabby and dreary, and you're filming in the hot sun and you're sweating and you look like crap. And then it goes through the whole editing process, the cleanup, the lighting, the adding of music, and the final product is phenomenal.
Mm.
And to film a 10-second segment can take as long as an hour and a half or 2 hours. Mm. And I used to get very annoyed with people when you're watching a film, say in your living room, and they decide to go and make a sandwich. And I'm like, all that time you missed, number one, it's in the film for a reason. Okay, otherwise it'll be on the cutting room floor.
Yes.
And the amount of effort that went into filming all that bits you missed, it's someone's blood and sweat.
Yeah.
And so when my appreciation of movie has increased a lot since making movies,
yeah.
I focus.
Right.
And I generally focus not on what's happening in front of the screen, mm-hmm. but what's going on behind.
Right.
The extras, the truck that pulls up for no apparent reason. There's a reason. Someone knows the reason why that truck pulled up. Mm. We don't know.
So what next for you? I mean, you've obviously loved this experience, because he would come swanning up from Bangkok after like a month's shoot.
It was 3 months. Fabulous. 3 months with long hair.
Yeah, big beard. The beard was rather bushy.
what is next?
Yeah.
I'm in the process of doing another Ramba extravaganza.
Oh,
a Christmas extravaganza on the 17th of December.
Is everyone invited?
The world and their neighbor. The world and their dog. Is that what you say?
Yes.
The world and their
you too.
Yes. Everyone's invited. It's purely Christmas. And you know what?
Yeah, fair enough.
You miss it, it's fine. We will do one every month and a half to 2 months.
So it'll be a similar concept? People similar want to come in, people want to do activities?
It's technically an open mic, but we do get people registered and rehearse ahead of time. Costumes are phenomenal. So you've got the choices of all the Ramba costumes or whatever you want. And they're backup dancers.
Ah, wow.
We bring in our sound system and people, so it sounds good. And what you end up with, a bunch of happy people in the audience, tons of photographs and great videos. Again,
right up your street. Schumann likes taking videos and pictures of himself.
Yes.
He does self-portraits at midnight. Did you see like a naked Schumann lying in a road at 2 a.m? He's doing a little self-portrait.
Yes. There are very few people in the world that enjoy looking at pictures of themselves.
Or you naked. Oh, lovely Schumann. Yeah. Oh, that's nice.
Those you've seen were censored.
So so tell us about, like, if people watching this are interested in getting involved or getting into the film industry.
Okay.
Chiang Mai has quite a vibrant international film industry. We've got Living Films, we've got a few big companies, we've got directors, we've got BAFTA award-winning videographers, we've
exactly.
got sound engineers. So we...
So...
Yeah, tell us
how
about
to get
that.
Into films. You can do what I did, which was... What a lot of people
sexual
who...
Sexual favour.
Yeah, I wish I'd slept with someone. I would have got better filmed. There's no one I know I could sleep with, so that was out.
Not Charlie.
No, I don't think he could get me into a film. But It's all about being at the right place at the right time and knowing the right people. And it was me at the right time seeing that email that I would never have opened and clicking on it, and it just happened. You know, it was just luck. I've not been to acting school. I act as me when I'm on film and I'm on stage. You learn a few things. You learn different accents, you learn different movements, but it's a lot of times if you're starting off as a as an extra or featured extra or a notable part in a film, but not the main people, they hire you for you, what you look like and what you can do. A lot of my friends in Bangkok have agents, and I don't. And I'm strongly against using an agent because they are horrible. They don't do any work for you, and they take 30% off. Now, a lot of people who are agents watching this will probably be lynching me.
We went out
There
with
are
fire.
some very cool people that I've come across who are agents that have made it very clear that in the times of pre-mobile phones and pre-social media, trying to get into film was hard. Now it's posted everywhere.
Exactly.
And just because someone sends you a post does not warrant them getting 30,000 baht out of 100,000 baht work
Good point.
for sharing a post. Times have changed. You should look at that agency fee. So what I do is I network and I have a whole bunch of people in different production houses who know me. If they need me in the film, they call me. So I sound like a prima donna
Oh,
saying, you
yes, you
know,
do.
I don't go for work. It comes and that's how I've treated both my film work and my relationships.
It's worked for you.
It's not worked in relationships.
Oh.
You know, I don't go looking out for people. I wait for them to come to me, and
They don't.
it's been 20 years or so, and
Well, that's where I'm going wrong as well.
and we need to
I'm
rework,
just sitting here like waiting.
waiting patiently.
Yes.
So yes, I would strongly say do whatever you enjoy doing, whether it's singing or acting or karaoke or dancing. Do it. Try and do it well. Meet people. Network. Networking in today's world is the only way to get ahead. And be willing to try new things. And, you know, it's going to be scary. The first time you do your first film, you'll be shaking and wondering, you know, just let it go. If you do something wrong, they'll tell you.
Yeah, and to those critics, because I know that there's a few people who are a bit critical of the theatre and the classical music performance scene, saying that it's not quite professional, it's not in world standards. Well, it's not. But the only reason it's going to get there, if we support it. So there we go. My mate, Shuman Tharan. Did I get it right that time?
Close enough.
Close enough. There we go.
I
Thank you so
can't
much,
say your
mate.
last name,
Oh,
so
go on, say it.
I'm gonna say
Who?
it. I
Who?
don't even. I
No.
you know, to me, your name is Kapinski. Okay. Like
Kimothy.
that. Sorry,
Okay.
digger.
Sorry, but
Oh.
thank you, babe. So what do you tell? Oh, you too. Bye.